Good afternoon, everyone. I am Tarun Kumar, practicing chartered accountant. I welcome you all in today's webinar brought to you by Taxman Publications. I'll just walk through a quick introduction, then I'll hand over to our speaker of the day. Our topic for today's webinar is COVID-19 impact on companies and auditors and the way forward. We have with us our expert speaker for the day, CS Santosh Malar. Friends, CS Santosh Malar is a rank holder chartered accountant. He has over 16 years of experience in accounting, auditing, taxation, and assurance. He has extensively worked on IFRS, Ind AS audit, and conversion engagements. He has authored various books on AS and Ind AS. He has been part of several technical study groups of the ICAI. He is an eminent speaker on financial reporting and corporate governance. I welcome CS Santosh Malar.
Thank you, Parish.
So here's brief about Taxman. Taxman is leading publisher on tax and corporate laws in India. It maintains the online database on income tax, GST and corporate laws. It also maintains the national website of the income tax department with technology and editorial support. Here are a few tips for attendees. Your mic is on mute. You may post your queries in the chat box on your right hand side. Your questions will be answered by the speaker after the session or during the session by the R&D team. After the session, you will get a copy of the presentation for your future reference. So here is agenda for the webinar. Friends, we all are going through challenging times. We all are navigating through uncertainty for ourselves, our loved ones, and our community. The number of COVID-19 cases are horrifying. Cases across the globe are around 10 million, and India has recorded around 500,000 confirmed cases. But the good part is that recovery rate in India is nearly 57%, which is a good sign. And there are trials of vaccines in a very advanced stage. So let's hope for the best. Friends, the COVID-19 pandemic has stalled economic activity at an unprecedented scale. The pandemic could be one of the most serious challenges faced by the industry in a nearly century. It has forced people to work from home. We are seeing fall in demand, lower income, production shutdowns, job losses, and all these things are adversely affecting business houses. With the world coming to a standstill, we are facing the spiral effect of COVID-19 in the form of economic uncertainty and financial strain. Our profession is also not immune to it. There are challenging times for auditors ahead. The current situation presents a unique set of challenges for the companies and auditors. And there could be a wide range of implications on financial reporting that should be considered by the management while preparing the financial statements and the auditors for the purpose of reporting in the short and medium term. Companies would have to consider consequences of COVID-19 in the context of their financial reporting, and auditors are expected to put in extensive efforts while conducting the audits in current and post COVID-19 environment. Now I won't be taking much of your time, so I would request CS Santosh Malar to start with his deliberation. Please, sir.
Sure. Thank you, Tarunji, for the nice introduction, and very good afternoon, everyone. And welcome to the webinar. Friends, as Tarunji said, that this COVID-19 has indeed, it's having a significant impact. It's one of the worst human, economical, and financial crises that humankind has actually seen. And financial reporting is no different. I mean, one of the most impacted area is the economy. Apart from we are seeing so many cases in India, so many cases elsewhere, so many deaths, so many people hospitalized, quarantined. So apart from this COVID pandemic being an a human crisis, it's also having a significant impact on business, as we all know. Some of the most affected businesses are aviation, hospitality, your restaurant business, leisure, entertainment, any kind of transportation, logistics, and so on. So these sectors are more impacted, but some way or the other, all other sectors, as we are seeing amongst, you know, our companies or chartered accountants amongst their clients, it is having a far-reaching impact. I see quite a few people joining just now, so maybe I'll again do a quick revamp on the topic for the day. So this is a webinar on COVID-19 financial reporting impact and auditors' consideration. one clarification. One, while the topic is the heading of the topic is COVID-19, but as we all know, friends, even before COVID-19 broke out in India, a sense of economic slowdown had already started, you know, until December, January, February, and so on. So it was not that the economy, our economy, was in great shape even just prior to COVID-19. A lot of banks, a lot of NBFCs were looking at increased NPA levels. A lot of companies in sectors like infrastructure, real estate, were actually already feeling the, you know, the brunt of economic slowdown of activities. COVID-19 has taken the slowdown to the next level, in the sense that because of the restrictions in travel, lockdowns, the shutdowns of manufacturing units, of offices, of various sectors, the economic slowdown has further been accentuated. And unfortunately, the events which are occurring at the border, both the Chinese and the Pakistan border, they are not very encouraging. And so as a country, we are in one of the most precarious situations at the moment. And it's not just COVID-19, but the entire, the anti-China thing, which can have a significant bearing on our economy, given that we have so much of trade that happens between India and China. So all these events would have a ripple effect on the economy, and accounting or financial reporting is nothing but, after all, a manifestation of the business activities of the company. So it's inevitable that it would have an impact on financial reporting, and thereby our auditing procedures, auditing reporting, and so on and so forth. So most of us would be aware of all these things. By now, RBI, some of these agencies, rating agencies like Moody, S&P, Fitch, CRISIL, have actually given a very discouraging outlook for the GDP growth in the next year. Unemployment is at an all-time high. So because of lockdown, because of so many laborers going back to their states, there is a lot of unemployment because some of those states may not be able to employ them effectively. So all this is having a major ripple effect on the financial state reporting. Most of you who follow the results, the financial results, the Q4 financial results of companies, have seen the results, and you have seen notes and COVID-19 impact. Of course, SEBI has now mandated that the impact of COVID-19 needs to be disclosed to the stock exchange, and so all companies need to do that. So what we are seeing in practice, some of the key impact areas: asset impairment. So what is happening is companies who have invested significantly in fixed assets, be it aviation companies having invested in airlines, manufacturing company having putting up major units. The immediate question from an audit standpoint or from a financial reporting standpoint is whether there should be any impairment in assets, because the demand is slowing down. The products that companies are selling, the demand has significantly slowed down for most, for most goods, for most non-essential goods. And thereby the inevitable question for accountants is asset impairment. And asset impairment, again, many companies, and in this session, what I've done is I've taken certain extracts from financial results of listed companies, which are there in public domain, and we'll kind of get a sense of what is being done and what is being discussed between the companies and auditors. So asset impairment, as we know, Ind AS 36 or AS 28 requires you to test the recoverable amount, compare the recoverable amount, which is the higher of the fair value less cost of sale, or the what is known as the value in use, basically the present value of the estimated cash flows, this is compared, the higher of this two, these two measures are compared to the carrying amount. And if there is a deficit, you go for a provision of impairment. For those companies who are live on Ind AS, Indian Accounting Standards, the trade receivables and other financial assets are tested for, you know, tested for impairment based on what is known as expected credit loss provision. So that is again one of the most impacted areas. So if you look at some of the NBFC companies who follow Ind AS, they have had a significant increase in the expected credit loss provision on their loan portfolio. Likewise, some of the manufacturing companies or non-financial servicing companies, they have actually made a higher provision as compared to last year because of them not being in a position to ascertain that their customer base will actually be paying them on time. The realization of their debtors would be on time, as you know, in the historical one. Coming to inventory, and this is one area where we have, as an auditing fraternity, have been grappling with. Because of the travel restrictions and lockdown, inventory physical verification has not been able to take, during the months of March, April, the way it normally does. So that has been one of the pain areas. Institute has issued certain guidance on this, on how to go about inventory physical verification. And obviously there are specific reporting requirements under CARO, which one has to, as an auditor give, whether the physical verification is at regular intervals. So that is one area where we will have to, focus on as an auditor. And apart from physical verification, a lot of companies have seen inventory write down because of the decline in commodity prices. For example, oil has been, there has been a very steep decline in oil prices across the world. And also because of the factories not being able to, since the activities at the factories have been stopped during the months of March, April, etc. In most parts of the country, the absorption for the purpose of inventory valuation, the absorption of the factory overheads, the requirements of the standard may require you to, may result in an inventory write down of on account of non-deployment of factory during the lockdown period. So we'll see that in a certain, a subsequent slide. I have a couple of examples on inventory valuation. Revenue, again, this is an impacted area. Most because of the travel restrictions, companies have not been able to kind of transport their goods to the customers or to the distributors. So revenue recognition has taken a significant hit. Many sectors like hospitality or travel. So for example, hotel industry is calling this June quarter as a almost a zero revenue quarter. So generally this is, the summer season is otherwise a very peak season for travel and leisure and hospitality. But this is, one of the worst peak season that this sector is actually seeing. Many companies are struggling with going concerns. As an accounting standard requirement, companies, the management needs to assert that the balance sheet is on a going concern basis. The company has the intention and ability to carry on its activities on a going concern. Now, because of this pandemic and because of all these operational issues, both on supply side, on the finance side, on the demand side and the operational side, many companies are actually struggling with the issue of going concern. And as an auditor, this is one of the key areas to look out at. Again, I have a separate slide. I have a separate section on going concern where I will see some of the disclosures that some companies have given in their financial results. So we'll talk about that more in detail later. Financial instruments, Ind AS companies have seen a lot of issues arising on account of COVID under this financial instruments. How do you account for the moratorium? How do you account for modification in debt, whether it's derecognition, whether it's modification, or whether it's a catch-up of the EIR? ECL we spoke about in impairment, but all this packages, this moratorium or this relaxed payments that are coming up from banks, from a borrower's perspective, it is having a lot of, it's causing a lot of discussions on how to go about accounting for the debt moratorium period that the banks are giving. Debt covenants and debt servicing. Many companies are actually in a, you know, a liquidity strained condition, so they are struggling to meet their debt covenants or debt servicing. And under both IGAAP as well as Ind AS, the consequence of a company breaching debt covenants can be far-reaching. To start with, the liability, the entire liability may have to be classified as a current liability. You may have to give the exact disclosures of what are the covenants and what was the breach all about. And if there are any penalties arising from the loan agreement or the borrowing agreement that emerge, that need to be provided for. Litigation on contractual defaults. We are seeing a lot of force majeure clauses being evoked by the companies. Most of the force majeure clause did not have a provision for any pandemic of such nature, any virus kind of a scenario, because in, you know, most of the Indian companies did not actually envisage that, you know, this force majeure can be caused because of a virus of this kind. Generally in India, and we have force majeures arising on account of, you know, war, riots, you know, burglary or something like that, but floods, cyclones. So contractual breach or contractual default or force majeure or material adverse event, these are the, you know, points which are being discussed amongst various companies. And this is again a topic which we'll come back to in a subsequent section in this session. A lot of companies have been evaluating whether the loss arising on lockdown can be classified as exceptional. Under Ind AS, as we all know, you cannot have an extraordinary classification of expenses or income, but you can call the you know, expenses, certain expenses, as exceptional if the, you know, if the nature, extent and timing of that expense or income is such that it calls for a separate disclosure in the P&L or in the balance sheet. So in several results, financial results, we have seen a lot of companies, including major companies, having classified the losses arising on account of exceptional items as arising on account of lockdown and exceptional items. Accounting for shutdown costs, there have been quite a few discussions, including at the institute's level, on whether the costs arising on account of shutdown can be, you know, how to deal with it. In fact, one of the constituents came up with a idea of, you know, capitalizing the cost of shutdown and and amortizing it over a period of 3 to 5 years. So various thought processes are going on, but by and large, based on the results that we have seen, most of them have expenses. Nobody has come up with such a creative accounting of capitalizing the shutdown costs. Insurance claims. As we all know, insurance, if there is a loss of profit, a claim on account of COVID-19, and in most of the cases, in my experience at least, it is not covered. But if at all there is one, then it can be recognized as an asset or a receivable only if there's a virtual certainty. If the realization is certain, you cannot account for it based on expectations. A lot of contracts have gone onerous because of, for example, if you have an office premise which is on lease and it is not occupied because of the shutdown and travel restrictions, and you're not able to so for example, if it's a retail outlet that you have leased, while the lease cost keeps continuing, but the footfalls are not happening because of the lockdown, and therefore there can be a question of onerous, whether this lease contract is an onerous contract, because while you have the lease cost on one side, but you're not generating revenue from that particular retail outlet. We all are seeing that we are witnessing a lot of fluctuations in the foreign exchange differences and the foreign exchange rates. And in IGAAP, we know that there was this famous paragraph 46A, which allowed foreign exchange differences on long-term monetary assets and liabilities to be, you know, either capitalized if it's pertaining to a capital asset, or to be deferred if it's not pertaining to a capital asset in reserves, deferred in reserves, and amortized in P&L over the period of the loan. So, but this clause, this paragraph had a sunset clause, that is until 31st March 2020. So as of now, we are not seeing any indication from the NEFRA, National Financial Reporting Authority, to extend that date. So in IGAAP, beyond this accounting of, deferral of foreign exchange differences beyond 2020, doesn't seem to be possible. Under Ind AS, of course, this is not a possibility. Ind AS does not allow that deferral kind of adjustment, except for the first-time adoption options that the companies would have availed under, for the existing items, for the old items. So, as a general rule in Ind AS, you will have exchange differences to be expensed out, recognized in P&L. So that was about the overall impact. In this and subsequent section, we'll see some of the most specific challenge areas that we are seeing. As I said, friends, we are seeing a lot of force majeure clauses being invoked, a lot of material adverse events being invoked, contractual penalties. So companies are actively discussing with their vendors, customers, suppliers, transport vendors, distributors about various, penalty clauses in their contracts, termination contracts. Many conferences and events are being cancelled, and that is one, again, another area where we are seeing a lot of force majeure clause. So let's take an example. Many conferences and events are being cancelled, which can result in a loss of deposits and or require penalties to be paid. So under Ind AS 37, these have to be accounted for. The penalty has to be accounted for if it is a result of a past event and the outflow is probable. So these non-recurring costs will need to be appropriately recognized, measured and presented and disclosed in the financial statements. Even when an entity has not made a decision to cancel an event, supposing, let's say, if an event was scheduled somewhere in July, okay, even when there is no decision to cancel, because people may say that you may be optimistic about things normalizing in July, or you may not be optimizing. So depending on that, you may not have formally canceled the event as yet. Consideration will have to be given to the issues relating to deposits and potential penalties if the event cancellation is probable in future. So again, if you go by the number of cases, let's say if you believe that July will be, will continue to be as it is, lockdown restrictions will be continued and gathering, etc., won't be allowed, then ideally you should make a provision towards the loss of deposit or loss or the penalty arising from the contract. It is important that the contracts are reviewed for termination and force majeure clauses are reviewed. Such assessment needs to be especially done as per AS 29 or Ind AS 37, under which all executory agreements that are likely to be onerous. So again, this question of onerous contracts is one of the key things. So for example, if the agreement is not going to be resulting in a revenue or, you know, economic inflow from the activity that was planned, but to wriggle out of the contract, you will have to, if you have to pay some penalty or, you know, termination fees, then chances are that it will be an onerous contract. Onerous contract is defined as something which has higher incremental cost as compared to the revenue which will arise from the contract. So you need to make a provision towards onerous contracts straight away. Let's take an example. An entity is engaged in tourism and hospitality, is heavily dependent upon the tourists from India traveling overseas and foreign nationals visiting India. In the light of COVID-19 outbreak across the globe, the entity has analyzed the likely impact of customer behavior coupled with bleak employment scenario on its revenue for next 1 year. This review has indicated possible substantial operating losses during next financial year, that is FY 2021. The entity is exploring the possibility of recognizing certain amount of operating losses as provision in the financial statements for current year itself, that is 19-20. So you have a scenario where this is a company engaged in tourism activities or hospitality sector. So it is, because of the current situation, envisaging significant losses for next year, that is financial year 2021. Its March 20 financials are still open. It has not closed. So it is thinking of making a provision for the expected operating loss in FY 19-20 itself. Is it permissible? So let's see. In the light of COVID-19 outbreak across the globe, after the review of expected that there might be possible substantial operating loss during next financial year, that is 2021. In this scenario, for the losses expected in next financial year, the entity cannot create provision for operating losses in current financial year itself in accordance with 37 or 29. However, an expectation of future operating losses might be an indication that certain assets of the operation may be impaired, and an entity tests these assets for impairment under the impairment standards. So the answer to this is that under accounting standards, you are not supposed to make a provision for future operating losses, because the definition of provision is the possible outflow of economic outflow arising from past events. So since the expectation is for losses in financial year 2021, you cannot, the standard doesn't permit you to make a, you know, anticipate that and make a provision in anticipation of future losses. Having said that, future losses might be an evidence for an impairment provision. So for example, if this company has, let's say, a hotel or let's say a resort somewhere, and you're not expecting the resort to be, you know, entirely occupied or occupied at a very suboptimal level for next year, then in that case, you will have to test that asset, that resort, that fixed asset or that property for impairment under 36 or AS 28. Reimbursement rights. Let's take an example. A reputed event and conference management company had obtained loss of profit insurance over a cover to mitigate the risk of potential business losses due to circumstances beyond its control. During the current accounting year, it has estimated a loss of profit of certain amount and initiated its discussion with insurance company for reimbursement of the losses. The entity is confident that insurance company will admit and honor its claim for loss of profits. Accordingly, the entity is considering recognizing an asset for this insurance claim recovery. So the question is, can the insurance claim recovery be recognized by the company? So again, here, as I said earlier, 37 and 29, they have certain thresholds for recognizing such reimbursement rights. So the entity, before it can recognize a receivable for the claim in on insurance company for business interruption, or popularly known as loss of profit insurance, must examine whether the insurance policy clearly covers the pandemic situation. The entity should recognize loss of profit recovery as an asset only if it's virtually certain, that is, the insurance entity has accepted the claims and insurance entity will meet its obligation. Otherwise, it will be considered as a contingent asset. So in this scenario, generally, it will be very difficult to recognize that recovery, because the threshold that both Ind AS as well as AS provide is virtual certainty. So ideally, you should wait for the virtual certainty level to be achieved. Some of the mitigating factors that we are seeing: companies in financial difficulties may seek additional financing, relief from being classified as NPAs, revise repayment terms or interest rates of existing debt agreements, or request waivers if they no longer satisfy the debt covenants. So a lot of companies are actually going back to their banks and financiers and requesting for waivers, for reliefs, for extension, for holidays in the payments, so on and so forth. So those actions need to be also figured out, or needs to be factored in by the management and auditors, in case of whether you have impairment or going concern or liquidity issues. The consequential impact of any non-compliances with debt covenants need to be appropriately dealt with in the financial statement. So for example, Ind AS 1 requires that if there is a material debt covenant, and which even after the balance sheet date, it has not been waived by the bank, then in that case, if it's a material one, then you need to reclassify the long-term borrowing as a current liability, because then the bank would stand a right to request for require the borrower to repay immediately. Lenders and borrowers both may enter into a contract to modify the terms of the financial instruments, such as bank loans. So again, we are seeing a lot of refinancing of loans by companies. Under Ind AS 109, the accounting for that depends on whether you meet the 10% criteria. So whether the present value of your revised cash flows discounted at the original effective interest rate compared with the carrying amount of the loan, whether the difference between the two is 10%. If it is 10%, then you derecognize the old one and recognize the new one. But if it is not, if the modification does not result in a derecognition, then you don't derecognize, but you just do a catch up. So you just whatever the revised cash flow, the discounted value of that at original effective rate, the difference between the two, you just recognize in P&L as an income. So that is about mitigating factors. So these and all these mitigating factors need to be considered.
So we are receiving a lot of queries. So Mr. Mayur is asking, can lease rentals on building during lockdown period be deferred due to force majeure? And if yes, how should these be accounted for?
Yeah, that is one of the common questions that is going on in various, internationally also. This ISB has also amended IFRS 16 to that, to have a guidance for that. So, Mr. Mayur, the framework I'm assuming is Ind AS, but even if, let's say, it's AS, under AS, what happens is, under AS 19, you have operating leases accounted for as you know, as you incur. So every month you expense out the lease rental cost, or as a lessor, you account for the lease rental income. So if there is a waiver on account of force majeure, then what happens? For those months, you will not account for it. So you will not have an expense. So since you don't have an asset and liability the way you have in Ind AS 116, the accounting impact will be that for those months that you have the concession from the lessor, you will not have an expense. So it is relatively simpler. Under Ind AS 116, what happens is if you have a lessor which is pardoning certain lease rentals, then there are two approaches. Then there are two alternative scenarios. One, if you are saying that force majeure was already there in the agreement, this is this is being exercised now, and therefore something, there's no modification of the agreement. Something which was already prevalent in the agreement has been now invoked, and therefore you will have whatever concessions you are getting, you will have a P&L income because it's a negative variable rental. On the other side, if it's not a force majeure, it's a modification. That is, there was no clause in the lease agreement which accommodated for this kind of a scenario. But nevertheless, the lessor has still given you a relaxation or concession in the rent payment, either an extension or a rent waiver for the lockdown period. In that case, what happens? This is what is known as a modification under 116. You need to rework your value of right of use and your lease liability at the current discount rate. Now, what's happening in practice is because the interest rates have gone up, what will happen is if you discount the new cash flows towards the lease rentals at the current discount rate, you may get a liability which is not, you know, too different from the original lease liability, or which at times may be higher than the original liability. Therefore, you may have a scenario where even if you have a lease reduction from the lessor, your liability is going up. So it's a very counterintuitive kind of a scenario because the interest rates have gone down. So therefore, what has happened is the institute has almost, you know, it's not an amendment to Ind AS as of now, because the NEFRA is discussing, but they have come up with a practical experience towards this, wherein what they are saying is, you don't worry about the modification accounting, because you would have realized that modification accounting is quite complex. So you just account for it as a P&L gain. So you keep it simple and account for it as a P&L gain. I hope that answers your question, Mr. Mayur. Okay, moving on to the auditing challenges. COVID-19 has caused unprecedented situation for businesses and environment, and changes at such a large scale has impacted almost each industry. Now, auditing community is facing various challenges, as we all know. Physical verification is one part. Second part is because of all this going concern issues around the sustainability of the company being challenged, whether the company continues to be existing on a going concern basis. So challenging that, having discussions around that, looking at the projections of the management, and so on and so forth. And then, you know, initially there were challenges around confirmations, bank confirmations, debtors confirmation, creditor confirmations, etc., not being, you know, available. So despite of several requests, initially many banks were not actually geared up to provide confirmations for March balances. Now, of course, things have improved since last few weeks as the, you know, the unlockdown has started. So, but then I understand many of the PSU banks are still struggling to provide confirmations for some of their clients. So these are some of the auditing, the challenges around the audit. The institute has, as I said, provided certain guidance for physical verification, and many companies, for a fact, have not still been able to conduct the physical verification of inventory as of 31st March also. So even for the March closing, the physical verification has not happened, unfortunately. So possible approach, what the institute says is you can have a rollback procedure. Let's take an example, the actual inventory cost or the stock take maybe, let's say 15th of July 2020. Separate information pertaining to any purchases of sales after 31st March 20 needs to be kept. With today's technology and inventory software, it should be possible for the company to manage this. Once the company has properly segregated this, it will need to take a look at all the invoices received and sent after 31st March 2020. During this part of the process, you may also want to double check your segregated inventory to make sure everything that has been set aside was received after that date. Once the stock is counted on, let's say 15th of July 2020, carry out the rollback procedure. So you need to account for all the sales, all the purchases, all the production, if any, or any destruction or any loss of the inventory that happened between 31st March to 15th of July, and work backward and derive at the stock level as of 31st March 2020. And this can be also kind of corroborated with the inventory level, which the client's inventory software, generally, typically in ERP, you have the MM model, which has, you know, on a rolling basis, on a perpetual basis, tracking the inventory, you know, on a real time, almost on a real time basis. So in such cases, you may have, you know, you can corroborate your rollback March 31st March 20 inventory level to the software of the client, and so to say, get a double comfort on that figure. Yeah, we'll look at some of the real life examples where companies in their financial results have actually disclosed, you know, the impact. So Reliance Industries had to write down its inventory, its you know, oil and gas inventory of to the extent of 4,245 crores due to the decline in the, you know, the prices of the oil. So this hit they took in the P&L, and this they classified as an exceptional item because of COVID-19. Likewise, SKF Limited, they provided this note. So these are the actual notes from the financial results. So they said that the management has performed an annual wall-to-wall inventory verification at each location as at December 19th, which was attended by the auditors. So what the position that they took is that they believe that it has taken into account all possible impact of known events arising out of COVID-19 pandemic. However, the estimated impact of global health pandemic might vary from date. So this is a case of a company which performed a roll forward procedure, not a roll back. So they had already done a stock take on 35, you know, during December 19th. So that they rolled forward in March. They couldn't do a, you know, another stock take in March 20. So they rolled forward the December figures for the purpose of audit. Couple of other examples, Piramal Enterprises. Again, they had a specific note relating to stock inventory in their results. So they said that the auditors were not able to observe the physical verification of inventory at certain locations, but they performed alternative procedures. These are extracts from the emphasis of matter. So these companies did not just have a note in their financial results, but their respective auditors also had an emphasis of matter for inventory valuation or for inventory physical stock take in the auditor's report. So they clearly said that they gave a disclaimer that they have not been able to perform the annual physical verification, observe the physical verification. And as per SA 501, the inspection of supporting documents relating to purchases, production, sales, results by the management, in such a third party evidence have been obtained sufficient. So they have said that they have performed alternative procedures, but they couldn't themselves observe the process, and therefore they have given a emphasis of matter. Apart from physical verification, as we saw in the case of Reliance Industry, in many instances, there can be an inventory write down on account of obsolescence or, you know, so for example, in case of inventory that is perishable in nature, because of the lockdown, if the inventory was not, you know, being replenished on, you know, based on the normal basis, then there will be an issue of whether it has, the inventory has perished, and therefore you need to have an inventory write down. Another aspect here is the inventory valuation process itself. The absorption of the factory overheads, if the factory, there has been no production during, you know, part of the year, the overheads pertaining to that part of the year where there were no activities, the overheads will need to be expensed out, and it cannot be loaded on the inventory as an inventory cost based on the requirements of AS 2 and Ind AS 2. So whatever salaries that you would have paid to the factory laborers or factory staff, that cannot be treated as part of the inventory cost. That will have to be expensed in that scenario. Before going on to the next section, Tarunji, any questions around inventory? That
yes, sir. Sir, there is an additional liability on the auditor's report under CARO. So will there be a CARO qualification in case inventory could not be physically verified during the current year due to the ongoing lockdown situation?
Yes, that's again a good question. So the requirement in CARO is whether physical verification of inventory has been taken place as regular intervals.
Right.
Now, supposing, you know, like the scenario that we saw in the one of the examples, that if, let's say, if you have done the physical verification, let's say in December,
right,
and you couldn't do it in March because of the lockdown. So that is one instance where, you know, you have verification, you couldn't do it in March, and therefore I would say that it would result in a commentary in the CARO that, for the, you know, if it's generally done on a quarterly basis, but we couldn't do it for March because of the COVID-19 scenario. But if the company does it annually, let's say many companies do stock take or inventory physical verification on an annual basis, and that is the regularity at which, you know, you, the stock take is conducted. If March to March is the cycle and this March you couldn't do, then it's actually a more serious issue where throughout the year you have not been able to do a stock take, and therefore that needs to be, you know, brought out clearly in CARO. Some of the more matured companies do it on a perpetual basis, that is almost on a real-time basis, that every, you know, month you have, you know, some third party or some, you know, independent person doing a stock take. Many retail companies, for example, do that. So in that case, you are better off because you would have done stock take for 11 months, but not for, let's say, March month. So you can bring out that positivity in your CARO comment.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Moving on to the impact on financial reporting. Going concern. As a company, the accounting standards require you to have a good, strong basis for the company to have the intention and ability to continue on a going concern basis. Under COVID-19, there are challenges like, you know, you need to have updated financial forecasts for foreseeable future, but at least for 12 months, not less than 12 months. Updated sensitivity analysis, you know, a kind of a stress test analysis that, let's say, if your demand or cost of goods or your cost of borrowing goes up on a worst come scenario or a, you know, a base scenario and a best case scenario. So you need to figure out what is the sensitivity and what level would it take for you to not to be able to carry on as, on a going concern basis. Forecasted compliances and lack thereof with banking and other covenants for foreseeable future and any other information. From an auditor's perspective, this is again a very challenging scenario because how much do you challenge the forecasted forecasts prepared by the management? Because as an auditor, you would have your limitations. You cannot really, and currently the way it is going, we don't know where it is going to end, whether it's going to be ending in November, COVID-19 will the vaccine be out in market by, let's say, September, October, or, you know, there are other claims. Many believe that November will be the peak of COVID-19. So till November, you would see cases rising exponentially. So we don't know what kind of scenario will we be in next 1 year. And mind you, going concern is something which for next 1 year, you should be in a position to carry on your business as a going concern. So this next 12 months is one of the most uncertain period for, you know, most of the companies in any case. So the dilemma for auditors is how reliable or how realistic are the forecasts that the accounting and the auditing standards require the management to prepare? And how much can you actually do a sensitivity? What can be the worst come scenario? So, for example, we were doing like ECL testing for one of the NBFCs, and in that stress test basis, and one of the requirements is reasonable and supportable evidence. So what is reasonable? I mean, there is no assumption today which is beyond the realm of, you know, actual things happening. So we all saw that oil prices for some, you know, for a few days, it was actually going in negative because of that, what happened in that WTI in the US. So the dilemma for the auditors to challenge these forecasts is actually, one of the most serious ones that we don't know. And therefore, many auditors, as we saw, resorting to EOMs or to comment, to audit reports not being, to being modified. Going concern, some of the factors that need to be considered while assessing the going concern assumptions: impact on economy and asset prices. So, for example, because of China, the issue that has arisen at the border. Many electronic companies, their supply chain has got erupted because, if you are saying that you want to boycott Chinese companies, most of our electronic goods, most of our, APIs in the pharmaceutical sector, the ingredients required for pharmaceutical products come from China. So if you want to boycott China, then how is it that, you are going to have alternative suppliers? And therefore, there can be serious issues on such companies for going concern. Impact of various measures taken by RBI for providing liquidity or government assistance. Whether the entity is operating in a highly impacted sector. So, for example, hospitality, aviation, leisure, entertainment. Whether the entity has the liquidity. So again, the companies which are relatively safer are the ones which are not leveraged. So companies which are having less of borrowings are better, positioned to kind of survive than highly leveraged companies, because on the demand side there is uncertainty. But let's say if you have a high interest commitment or high EMI commitment on the other side, you will have you will be financially stressed. So these are the things that one has to, as an auditor, one has to really consider while assessing whether the going concern assumption is appropriate. Here's one example of a listed company in a hospitality sector. It's a hotel, Lemon Tree Hotels, where they have given, this is the extract from the financial results. I won't read it in full in interest of time, but this is one example where the scenario seems to be that going concern is really discussed at length with the auditor, and they have performed some valuation of some of their properties, and they have a reason for mitigating the going concern basis. And here's the emphasis of matter that the auditors have given in the auditor's report. They have emphasized on this particular note that they have, the client has given in the financial results. I won't read it at length because of paucity of time. Here's another example, Indigo, Interglobe Aviation, Indigo Airlines. As we all know, world over, not just in India, world over, airlines are, worst affected by this COVID-19. Many international, many very large international airlines like, the British Airways or even the Emirates, they have laid off a lot of staff, and Virgin Australia, one of the airlines in Australia, has actually gone, for bankruptcy. So it is a very somber scenario for airline industry as such. So you are going to see, and the auditor here in case of Interglobe has also given an emphasis of matter in his report. Other key,
So we are receiving one query. Sure. So we are seeing that EOM para these days is widely used by the auditors. So how banks and other statutory agencies are look on these EOM para?
No, it's definitely a red flag from the perspective of banks and other providers of finance. So be it the banks or private equity firms who have funded the company, or even the from the stakeholders' perspective, the shareholders' perspective, EOMs, especially those concerning, EOMs would be of various nature. If the EOM relates to inventory, physical verification not having taken place, then probably it's fine. It's it's something which is inevitable. It was lockdown, but and therefore you couldn't carry out the inventory stock. But if the EOM is pertaining to impairment or going concern, then obviously it's a very serious scenario, because then there would be issue of going concern. And we all know that this bankruptcy code IBC has been suspended for a few months because of that's one of the relaxation that the government has given. Now, immediately that relaxation is open, that means that, there can be a claim that one of the creditors may give to the company, and therefore, it would be looked upon in a very serious manner from the perspective of banks and other stakeholders.
So, sir, can it be used as a substitute for qualification in the report?
Not really. I mean, if you look at the standard dealing with auditor's report, EOM is when EOM is a scenario where you cannot, where you're convinced as an auditor, you're convinced that the position that the client is taking, be it on a going concern basis or any other accounting position that the client is taking, is fine, but I still want to lay an emphasis on that particular position. Okay. Qualification is when I'm not agreeing with the client. So he's saying that I'm going concern. As an auditor, I'm not convinced with the going concern basis, and therefore I am. So that is a disagreement with the client, and of course that is much more serious. Emphasis of matter is something where I'm not exactly sure, because the subjective nature of the projections and forecasts and all is such that as an auditor I have my own limitations, and therefore I'm giving an EOM. I don't disagree with the management as such. in that case, again, it sets a red flag amongst the banks that this is something which can go wrong drastically unless something significant is done.
Right.
Employee benefits, we are seeing a lot of companies either reducing their staff strength, that is, there is a job cut, or there is a salary cut, or both. In that case, that can have an impact on employee benefit or payroll cost. Other impact can be, for example, you have defined benefit obligations where you have gratuity, for example. You account for gratuity provision as the net of the present value of the defined benefit obligation as per the actuary and the fair value of the plan assets. Now, here it's more like a double whammy. What happens is because of the fair value of the plan assets, if they are invested in government bonds and, you know, long-term government bonds, the value of that would have gone down because of the COVID-19. And also because of the interest rates having gone down, the liability towards this defined benefit obligation, the discount rate today, which most of the companies are using, is between 6 to 7%. So, you know, around 6.2 or 6.15, around that percent. So because it's a liability, the lower the discount rate is, you will have a higher liability. So again, you will have a higher obligation, higher provision because of increase in the liability and a reduction in the fair value of the plan assets. Termination benefits need to be provided at the earlier of when an entity can no longer withdraw the offer, if it's, let's say, a VRS kind of a scenario, and the entity recognizes the cost for the restructuring and involves payment of such benefits. Many companies are actually knocking off the compensatory, the accumulated leaves that employees had and, you know, what was provided against as of March. And because of the absences, because employees couldn't come to office during this lockdown period, a lot of companies are actually adjusting those absences against the accumulated leave that the employees had. And this can have a impact in March or June provisions that towards the compensated absences that companies made. ESOPs, a lot of companies are giving, ESOPs are modifying the terms of the stock-based options that employees had, and that can have an impact on the accounting. Modification accounting is again a subject on its own. So one has to be watchful towards that. Now, because of the lockdowns and a lot of people being, you know, working from home and a lot of employees, a lot of work happening remotely. So employees are kind of, you know, at their respective residences and work is still happening, let's say. Then you can have a scenario where the internal controls, the segregation of duties, or the, you know, the reviewer and the preparer and the reviewer mechanism, check mechanism that generally is there, can get, you know, relaxed or can get eased. Okay, for urgent payments or for urgent realizations and all that. So this, from an audit standpoint, puts into question that whether the internal financial control is appropriate, is operating effectively, especially during this lockdown period. And since we have to specifically report on this for, you know, as a, you know, a separate report in our audit report, one has to be careful that whatever internal controls over financial reporting were there, are designed to be there, they were in place even in the lockdown period. The processes need to be there. Due to COVID-19, with limited supervision, oversight, a few board meetings, limited cybersecurity, internal reporting, these possibilities of unintentional override of design controls or even planned frauds. Another point here is that cyber fraud, and again, I'll come to that in the next slide as well. Cyber fraud, or, you know, fraud through internet, that is also increasing because all of us are, you know, kind of, most of us are working from home these days, and we are using all these, you know, platforms like Zoom and various other ones. Those, you know, the security around that may not be, you know, it may not be a foolproof security, and therefore you have to be watchful of whether any client information, whether a company's information is being leaked, and therefore it can be misused, or, you know, whether frauds can be perpetrated through that. So that is one of the areas where we, as an auditing fraternity, you know, we don't really focus so much on that as compared to the traditional control. So that, in this scenario where people are working remotely, that is one of the risks that one has to be watchful of. I mean, the other day I stumbled on an article where it said that in Australia, the rate of cyber frauds has gone up by about 200% since last March, in this last two months. So that is something which is alarming. And one fraud can, you know, actually destabilize the entire company. So we may talk about various, you know, accounting, internal controls, etc. But one leak of data, it can harm the entire, it can bring down the entire setup of the company. So it can be a serious, quite a serious thing. Cybersecurity, I spoke about. Especially for those, you know, companies, many small companies have started using cloud services these days. So that is, again, the security around that, the IT general control security, the server controls, etc., has to be really looked into, not just by the auditors, but also by the company from its own security perspective. Yeah, so Tarunji, that is about it from my side. We'll be happy to take a few questions if you believe time is there.
So we have already crossed the time limit. So this was really a wonderful session with the real life examples you have given. So friends, there is an unprecedented level of uncertainty about the economy, future earnings, and many other inputs that have started to pose the challenges both operationally and financially. So I think auditors and management must remain focused on their ethical responsibilities and on the public interest. So it is time for us to exercise the professional judgment with due care. So I once again thank Santosh Malaji for enlightening us with his vast experience and knowledge. Sir, I request you to give your concluding remarks, then we will sign off.
Yeah, sure. So basically, this patch of time is quite a challenging one for both companies, for businesses, and for the auditors. I think one of the points that one must keep in mind, in fact, the major point is, so far as an auditor is concerned, that while you would like your client to be operating on a going concern basis, you know, companies should survive, and, you know, as an auditor, we should survive. A major point is there is no relaxation anywhere in the world so far as auditors' duties are concerned. We all know that in India, the regulatory authority on audit has only been increasing. We now have NEFRA, National Financial Reporting Authority, and so on. So there is no expectation that auditing procedures or audit process will be less stringent in this difficult time, unfortunately. So while there are business challenges, financial reporting challenges, but as an auditor, we have not been pardoned from our job of, you know, conducting a stringent audit exercise, because we play the vital role. I mean, of course, ultimately, as I said, accounting is nothing but a manifestation of the performance and the position of financial performance and position of the company. So we are doing a service to the stakeholders, the shareholders. So one shouldn't relax the audit quality as such during this tough time. Albeit, you know, even if we have a sympathy for the companies, you know, going through a tough time. That's all.
Thank you, sir.
And thank you all for your participation today.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. And thank you, Taxman team, for organizing such a wonderful webinar. So you will be receiving the copy of the PPT and the link of video for your future reference. Thank you, everyone.
PPT is already shared in the webinar only. You can download from that, and we will be sharing an ebook at 4 o'clock.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.